Today, I want to talk to you about the indisputable Savior. There was a prophecy about this Jesus. He went about healing people. He said that he had come to show the world who the Father is. God said that he was the Son of God who would die for our sins and be resurrected on the third day. Well, there was quite a stir when he died, and the Romans wanted to make sure, the Jewish leaders wanted to make sure that he didn't come out of that grave and that no one took him. So they put a Roman guard around him. The question is today, do you believe it? Many of you who are watching may not. I'll tell you what, there was a point where all of us sitting here didn't believe. And yet God has done something for us in such a way, it may look radical to you, but we're rejoicing because of the goodness that he's brought into our lives and the joy that comes with salvation and knowing that you're forgiven. You may not think Jesus is the door. Years ago, I was speaking on a Sunday night, and I talked about a car that I had, an old car that the door had broken on the driver's side. And for months, I had to go around to the passenger side and climb over into the driver's seat because my door was broken and wouldn't open. I told that story in a sermon and talked about my old car, and a few weeks later, one of the deacons from the church said to me, "Pastor, how's that door working?" I said, "What do you mean? It's still broken." He said, "No, when you talked about that 3 weeks ago, I went out there and fixed it." I said, "Are you kidding me?" For 3 weeks, I'd been coming in the passenger door, climbing over the console, and the door actually worked. Maybe you think that the door, Jesus Christ, isn't one that really works. Well, not only is he the door, but there's no other door. Here's what it says in John 10:9, "I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved." Have you decided that that door doesn't work? Let's take a look at some evidence today that this door, Jesus Christ, is the only one that is the Savior, the indisputable Savior that was prophesied to become the Messiah and take away the sins of the world. John 14:6 says this, "Jesus answered, 'I am the way, I am the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.'" Only Jesus can bring salvation where you can go to heaven. You say, why only Jesus? Because there was only one plan of God. Sometimes there's just one plan. And God made it work where we could be forgiven. You had sinned, I had sinned, we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But Ephesians 2:8-9 lets us know that God made a way through his mercy and grace that we might be saved and be forgiven. And we can't earn it. It's just the grace of God offered with mercy. So let's pray. And I'm going to ask that the Holy Spirit would speak to our hearts and confirm this reality that Jesus is the way. And we need to take him as our Lord and Savior. Father, for all who are watching, for all of our campuses, for everyone sitting under the sound of my voice, let your Holy Spirit move in such a way that everyone would know that Jesus is Lord and give him complete control of their lives. May it be, I pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Today I want to talk to you about the proof that Jesus is the door, that Jesus is the Messiah. Few historians deny the existence and the death of a man in history named Jesus Christ. I've been to Israel. The whole nation is abuzz about the history of where Jesus was and what he did and how he lived. Secular and Christian historians alike know that Jesus lived and that Jesus had a great following. But you know what? There's more than that. There's evidence of his resurrection that I believe is indisputable. And I want to talk to you about this indisputable Jesus. The historian Luke said this in Acts 1:3. "He also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs." That's what the word says, infallible. "Being seen by them during 40 days and speaking of things pertaining to the kingdom of God." So what are these proofs? This is so important. I like what Dr. David Jeremiah says. He says, "Faith is not trusting God despite the evidence. It's placing logical trust in something reliable." This is an historical account, and the information that I'm going to share is provided by Dr. David Jeremiah from his book, Overcomer. He did tremendous research on this, and I just want to share it with you, this indisputable proof. The first is the soldiers. Here's proof that he really did die, and he really was resurrected. By the way, Romans knew how to kill you. They knew how to crucify. They didn't make a mistake when they pulled Jesus off that cross and put him in a tomb alive. He was dead. They knew how to make sure of that. And then, because of this prophecy that was given that he would rise again in 3 days, the Roman government and the Jewish leaders wanted to make sure that nobody took this body and that this couldn't go on as a story that would cause more problems. They wanted him dead for a reason. So the Roman government, at the behest of the Jewish leaders, put a contingent of soldiers assigned to the guard and assigned to guard the tomb of Jesus day and night. Here it is in Matthew 27:65. Pilate said, take some soldiers and go guard the tomb the best way you know. Well, the Romans were the best soldiers in the world, and they knew how to do it. Here's how they did it. A Roman guard with 16 soldiers, each trained to protect 6 feet of ground around them. 4 stood immediately in front of what was supposed to be protected. In this case, it was the tomb. Thieves would have had to walk over sleeping guards and then confront 4 guards who stand guard directly in front of the tomb. As 4 stood there, and they changed those 4 out every hour on the hour in the night, the other 12 would lay in a semicircle around the area that they were protecting. And it would have been very tough. It's not plausible that someone could have got through and these guards didn't see it, didn't get it, weren't there. They're the best soldiers in the world. It's not a reasonable hypothesis to say that they couldn't break through or that they could break through. And then the second proof is the seal. It's called the seal because there's actually clay that goes with it that they seal. You see it in Matthew 27:66. So they went to the tomb and they made it safe from thieves by sealing the stone in the entrance and putting soldiers there to guard it. So this seal that the Bible speaks of consisted of a cord that stretched across the rock and was fastened at either end with sealing clay. That's why it's called the seal. And it was stamped with an official signet of the Roman governor, which means you mess with the seal, you get the wrath of the government and the Roman soldiers upon you. So now the grave robbers, that's what they were saying, that his grave was robbed. That's what people say today. He didn't really die and he didn't really rise. And we're giving proof here. Now those robbers would have had to get past the soldiers, break the seal, and incur the wrath of the empire, literally. And then there's the stone. The stone was in front of a sepulcher. A sepulcher was a place that was carved out in the rock. And the carving and that cave had to be so big that you could carry a dead body in. And then the stone had to be so big that where you carried that body in would be covered. It's a large stone to cover the tomb. And here it is in Matthew 27:59. Then Joseph took the body and wrapped it in clean linen cloth. He put Jesus' body in a tomb that he had had cut out of a wall of rock. And he rolled a very large stone to block the entrance of the tomb. Then Joseph went away. So now the robbers would have had to have gotten by the guards, undone the seal, moved the big rock enough to cover a hole in the tomb that you could carry someone through and not be seen. One of the most interesting books on this subject was written by English journalist Frank Morrison, a skeptic of Christianity. He didn't believe it. He set out to disprove it. And after all of his research to disprove the resurrection, after poring over all that evidence, he was unable to disprove it. As a matter of fact, it affected him so much that the weight of the evidence convinced him of this truth, that Jesus did live, that he was the Messiah, that he was resurrected, and Frank Morrison became a Christian. He set out to disprove it, but he couldn't disprove it. And he wrote a book, and you can get it if you're a skeptic, Who Moved the Stone? A Powerful Defense of the Resurrection. The fourth evidence we see is the sepulcher. This is the cave that was honed out, the tomb that they put the big rock in front of. Everyone agrees that the tomb is empty. People who are followers of Jesus believe the tomb is empty, he's resurrected. People who don't follow Jesus say it's empty, but his body was stolen. Everyone agrees it's empty. How could the disciples steal the body without being noticed? How could they get past the guards? Why would they incur the wrath of that Roman Empire? But I'm going to tell you, I think the biggest evidence is these disciples, these 11 apostles that are left. They saw him. He presented himself after his death. They saw him die. They saw him afterwards. And we'll talk about that in just a moment. And they believed it so much that they were willing to give their lives and suffer and die for the cause of Jesus Christ. Now, if you'd made this story up and they told you they were going to kill you and they had the sword to your neck and they were ready to take your life, if you'd made up the story, do you think you might say, hey, okay, I deny it. It's not real. It's not true. They died for him because they knew it was real. They saw the miracles. They walked with him and they were willing to give their lives. The only one that was not martyred was John the Beloved, who was boiled in oil and isolated on an island at the end of his life, but he lived to die a natural death. Everyone else was killed for the cause of Christ as martyrs. That's pretty good evidence that they really believe this. It's not a hoax. They died because they knew that Jesus had overcome death. And I'll tell you, the authorities didn't move his body. Some say, well, you know, the Romans might have taken it. Well, if they had taken the body, they could have shown it to anyone to show that he didn't rise up, that he wasn't alive. But they couldn't show it because they didn't have the body. And then there's more evidence, the shroud. John 20, another one of the Gospels, gives an account. Verse 3, so Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. And both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and he looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but he did not go in. Verse 6, then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. And finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and he believed. On the video that was playing during communion, you saw the grave clothes where they sunk down, testifying to the fact, as it was re-shown for us, that Jesus literally left those clothes, those grave clothes, and he rose. One scholar said it this way: there were grave clothes in the form of a body, slightly caved in and empty, like the empty chrysalis of a caterpillar's cocoon. Seeing that would make a believer out of anybody, this guy says. That's amazing. And then there are the scars. This is how he presented himself to the apostles when they were so afraid. He's risen, and on that very first Easter evening, we see in John 20:19, when it was evening, on the first day of the week, Jesus' followers were together. The doors were locked because they were afraid of the elders. They'd just seen Jesus crucified. They had scattered. They're afraid. How are these guys afraid and running, but they come to a place where they'll give their lives? We're about to see why. Here it is. Then Jesus came in and stood right in the middle of them and said, peace be with you. They saw him die. They saw him put in the tomb. He said, peace be with you, because they were scared out of their minds in that moment. They were scared of the Romans. They were scared of those Jewish elders that were after them. They were running scared, but Jesus shows up after dying. He's resurrected. They've heard about it. And he says, peace be with you. Now they know he's in their midst. I'm going to tell you something. He's in our midst today. He's alive and he's real. And our lives give the greatest testimony of how he changed us and how he saved us. Why would we be so radical about who he is and what he's done if it wasn't real? A person with an experience is never at the mercy of a person with an argument. We've experienced it. They were experiencing him. Verse 20, after he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. His followers were thrilled when they saw the Lord. The scars were infallible, indisputable proof of his identity. Even doubting Thomas said in that moment, my Lord and my God. And then there was the sightings, maybe the best evidence. We know of a dozen post-resurrection appearances where Jesus on occasion showed himself. And on one occasion, 500 people were present. 1 Corinthians 15:5. Now I want to ask you a question. If you're in a court of law and you have over 500 eyewitnesses to something, do you think you could win the case? I bet you could. I bet you could. Listen here. And that he was seen by Peter. This is the word, 1 Corinthians 15:5. And then by the 12 apostles. After that, Jesus was seen by more than 500 of the believers at the same time. Most of them were still living today, but some have died. Then he was seen by James and later by all the apostles. Last of all, he was seen by me, the writer says, as by a person not born at the normal time. David Jeremiah, the doctor, says in his book, Overcomers, he appeared to men and women, to groups and individuals, in a house, on a street, to the disciples who were sad, and to those who were happy. On momentary occasions, and those that stretched out over a period of time, in different localities, and at different times of the day, several times he showed himself, and people were able to be eyewitnesses. But this is a Christian historian who writes here. What about the secular historian? Well, they all knew about the existence of Jesus. They all knew that he did miracles and that it was talked about in the land. They all knew that he had thousands of followers. You can find that in secular history, not just Christian history. But here's one of the historians who's not a believer named Josephus, not a Christian. And here's his account. They reported, Josephus says, that he had appeared, this is Jesus, to them 3 days after his crucifixion and that he was alive. Accordingly, Josephus says, he was perhaps the Messiah concerning whom the prophets have reported wonders. So here's the account. This is the evidence. The greatest evidence is you and I and how he changed our lives. Let me give you a little account of a changed life. My Uncle Glenn, I haven't seen him in years, but when I knew him as a young man and was hanging around him, he was a beer-drinking guy who didn't want to have anything to do with God. I mean lots of beer, not just a beer every now and then. My uncle, good guy, loved him. He was a good man, but he didn't want to have anything to do with God or Jesus or church. Matter of fact, he'd been invited to church where he was, and recently when I saw him, he told me this story. He refused invitations to go to church, refused to have anything to do with Jesus and this Christian thing. It just seemed like it couldn't be true. Just a bunch of fanfare that was false. That's what he thought. But you know what? He lives in Felton, California, in the mountains above Santa Cruz. And his house backs up to a little Baptist church. And every Sunday night, my Uncle Glenn would go out to lay in his hammock. And wouldn't you know that they had a sound system that worked pretty good in that little Baptist church. And it went a little further than the walls. And my Uncle Glenn, who probably wouldn't have darkened the door of a church, heard that preacher preaching. First, he didn't like it because it's taking his space and his peace, right? He's trying to lay in his hammock. But every Sunday night, he'd go out there and he'd hear that preacher preach over and over again. And something started happening. Now, I just want to tell you something. As a preacher, I don't have to be that good if I'll just share the truth about the gospel. Because the Holy Spirit attends that message. It is not a fair fight when it comes to the devil and the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit starts to move and can open up a heart that's completely closed. Maybe your heart has been completely closed. Perhaps this season where it's been so difficult causes you to hope that there's a God because life is hard. Well, there is a God. And he's made a way for us to draw close to him through Jesus Christ. Uncle Glenn listened week after week. And then one Sunday night, laying in his hammock in his backyard over the fence from the church, the preacher gave an altar call. And he said, pray this prayer. My Uncle Glenn prayed that prayer in his hammock right there with no one else around. And he came to Jesus Christ. Is that unbelievable, man? Isn't that the coolest story? Now he's a man of God. He goes to that church and loves people and reaches out and cares. God is so real and he's so good. And in this season that's been so hard, he's reaching out to you. Here's what it says in Ephesians 1, verse 7. In Christ we are set free by the blood of his death so that we have forgiveness of sins. How rich is God's grace? You say, die, blood, it seems so intense. Well, listen, here's what the Bible says, that all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The Bible tells us that God the Father is altogether holy and he can't cohabitate with sin. And now we've all sinned and we're separated from him and he loves us. How is he going to reunite us to himself? He made a bridge. He made a way through Jesus Christ. He said, I'm so altogether holy, I must punish sin. But instead of punishing my creation, you're created in the image of God. He loves you. He didn't want to lose you. So he made a way through Jesus Christ so that the wrath of the Father against sin, not against mankind, against sin that damages us all, wounds, hurts, kills, destroys. It makes sense when you think of murder and when you think of abuse and we think of these terrible sins that God can't have anything to do with that. That's not who he is. But he made a way that all could be forgiven by allowing the wrath, the righteousness of God to fall on Jesus Christ. He was bruised for our transgression. He was crushed for our iniquities. That's what the Bible says. He paid the ransom. He paid the price for my sin and yours. Why is he the only door? Why is he the only way? Because there's only one plan of God the Father to redeem mankind. And it came through his son, Jesus Christ, who paid the price. Open the door. Open the door. My Uncle Glenn said, no way, man. But the Holy Spirit started working. And now he loves Jesus. And he discovered that Jesus loves him. He's here to help you. He loves you. He wants to deliver you, set you free, and give you a home in heaven forever. The only way, Acts 4:12, is through Jesus Christ. Salvation is found in no one else. That's what the Bible says. In no other man. It's Jesus who paid the price. He's risen. The Bible says he's at the right hand of the Father, and he's making intercession for us. Some of us know him, some of us don't, but we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's not one that's righteous. I'm no holy Joe. I'm a guy who's forgiven. I'm a man who understands grace. I needed it. Thank God for his mercy. He's here for you too. Would you bow your heads? We're going to pray this morning. Father, thank you so much for sending your son, Jesus Christ, to die for our sins. If you're listening under the sound of my voice today, and you want to give your heart to Jesus, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand in just a moment. Every head bowed, every eye closed. We're just going to honor the privacy of people next to us. I'll be the witness before God if you raise your hand and say, I want to pray and invite Jesus into my life. Here's how it'll work. I'll count to three. You lift your hand at the end of three. And then you pray the prayer. I'll lead you line by line, but not alone. Everyone in this room will say the prayer out loud with you. We want to lend strength to your voice. We're not here to single you out or embarrass you. That's not necessary. But God the Father in his love wants to come and bring Jesus the Son. He's knocking on the door of your heart. Will you open it and let him in? I'll lead in a prayer line by line. This whole room will repeat it. And if you'll say it sincerely from your heart, the Bible says if we confess with our mouth and believe in our hearts that Jesus Christ was crucified and he's risen from the dead, we will be saved. That's all it takes. Say, okay, God, I surrender. I believe he's the way. The Holy Spirit is working now. I don't have enough persuasion to make your heart beat, to get you to the place where you know it's time and it's real. God the Father, Jesus the Son, the Holy Spirit is working to draw people right now. So with heads bowed and eyes closed, I want you to lift your hand on the count of three if you want to pray that prayer. No one looking around, please. One, two, three. Just lift your hand quickly if that's you today. Okay, God bless you and you. Keep it up. God bless you and God bless you. Maybe I didn't see your hand, but God does. Maybe you're at home watching, at one of our campuses watching. Would you say this prayer out loud? Everyone in the room, pray with those coming to Jesus. Say this. Say, Father God, please forgive me. I've sinned and I've made a lot of mistakes, but I believe that you love me. I believe that you gave your son, Jesus Christ, to die for my sins. Jesus, come into my heart and make me brand new. I'm going to follow you with my life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.